In this first case, we're going to walk through the actual process of applying some classification to some information. But the scenario here we're going to talk through, and then these use cases will all flow together. But the first one will be, we're going to take the role of an analyst, and the first person you see in the column on the left-hand side there. We have four people who've come together as part of a coalition. We have a mixture of Americans, Canadians, and they may be based in different locations. And here you're seeing some examples, either in a US location or a Canadian. They have certain clearances to their to information they have access to, whether a secret or top secret. And also in this taxonomy, we're talking about communities of interest or CUI or COI, where they have access to specialized programs or smaller communities. Or you can think about these as networks. And in this example, we're going to walk through. So Anne's the American analyst. And in this first use case, she'll be sitting in a US location where she's going to create these five different documents you see on the right-hand side, and we'll walk through the process of how do we classify, how do we tag this information and get this to the coalition group. And then we'll look at different, in the following use cases, about how to, what controls are in place to protect the information, make sure appropriate information is being read by the appropriate person and perhaps within an appropriate location as well. So we're just going to switch over to the demo now. So now we're going to take a look at some sample use cases where we're going to create the information for our use cases. The first case is to go create five documents. And so we're going to connect in as Anne. And Anne is going to be located in the US at this point. So we're going to go ahead and connect as her on an American machine. And she is an American citizen with clearances up to top secret. And we'll review this as we go through the process. There's a series of documents she's been working on here. So we're going to talk about the act of classifying this information. And we're going to walk through the process of seeing that there are some choices here in the very first document. It's not classified yet. If I come to save the document, I could be forced for that user to classify the information. And these lists can be very dynamic based on your case or whether or not they're allowed to actually create top secret or different levels of classification. The other thing we can help the user with as well is information that at a certain level, there are some of the other criteria we talked about applying to that. So whether or not a citizenship or location-based thing is important for a country, we can mark it with a releasable to, which would tell the system that it should only be within certain constraints. And or if it's something a little bit more sensitive, then we can introduce some other elements, whether other controls or communities of interest of what they have access to. In this case, we're actually going to just go through and just simply create this first document, which will be an unclassified document. I'm going to go ahead and save that. It's going to apply some visual markings to the document itself and the metadata that we talked about in the previous section. So we'll go ahead and close that document. That one's done. It's ready for the rest of her community, which is a compilation of American and Canadians with different security levels. This next document she's going to take a look at, and we're going to introduce the idea of helping the user classify in a helpful way. So let's say if I go through and classify this as an unclassified document, it's a spreadsheet part of the project. If I go ahead and save that, we're going to see something a little bit different in the experience. We're actually finding stuff in there. So it's helping the user along, trying to abide by the classification policy that things that with a credit card needs to be a higher classification, at least confidential. Thanks for the warning. But in fact, I'll go up to secret level for the second document. And in fact, I am going to bring that for the team. So anyone within the Canadian US environment can actually take a look at this information. We will raise it to classification. That was an example of the classification giving us some guidance as to what we should classify and apply the metadata to this document. Third one, we're going to get to something a little bit more sensitive, maybe. Here's another document we're going to classify. It's applying for a trademark that's in the US. Let's say it is sensitive. We want to keep it internal to a project at a secret level, but really this will only be applicable to people within the United States of America and not as applicable to anything outside of that environment. So we're going to start creating different combinations of classification, and we're going to then see the effects on that. So we'll go ahead and save this document, and you can see some markings that is going to describe, in addition to just the sensitivity around classification, but also its releasability or where can this document be accessed. And this fourth one, an interesting one, is we're going to have something to do with a fighter pilot aircraft carrier around radar detection. We're going to go ahead and save that. And from everything else I've been working on, so far, everything's been, you know, secret. So let's go ahead and do secret, and then we're going to go ahead and save that. And this behavior is going to be a little bit different because in addition to just on a sensitivity of your credit cards, we're going to get something a lot more specific. In this case, we're working on a special project where it's known based on stuff we've seen before or on this new keywords or through this document. In fact, this looks like Project Tiger or COI Tiger is applicable to this document and should actually be classification top secret. And it's already set these settings for us to help that user along. So this could be automated. In this case, it's suggested so the user can agree to that. And you can see the markings are appropriate to that environment. Last document we're going to classify here, those who recognize this diagram, it's actually the iPhone, one of the diagrams as far as patents for iPhone. But for our case, we're going to go ahead and save this document for our project team. We will have it classified as secret by choice. And in fact, there's a special classification for this where we actually want to limit it to not just the fact you got a clear security clearance, but you need to be partaking as part of two communities of interest to have access to that. And it's going to be bananas and lion for this example. All right, so we'll go ahead and save this document. We will get the visual markings, the metadata on the document itself, and we are good to go. So I've just walked through the act of, you know, Anne's come as part of the project. She's classified these new additions. She wants to share it with the team. So we're going to do it in two different ways. The first one is we'll go into SharePoint. There's a SharePoint up and running for the team. It's accessible for the team members, and we're just going to simply drag this up to SharePoint like we would normally do to get things within SharePoint. So we populate that, and we'll actually go ahead and check these in so people can see that the documents are ready for them to take a look at and take action on that. Go ahead and do the check-in. All right, so that's available for my team. You can see some of the visual markings coming through. And shortly, we'll talk about what these actually mean as far as the policies are concerned. Last one is I've actually got one of these documents, sample D. I'd like someone to pay attention to that first. So we're going to go ahead and email that to the team. And if I take a look at my team members, it's the ones that we were seeing in our spreadsheet at the beginning of this. I want them to all review a specific document. So we'll go ahead and create an email. And we'll attach a sample D. I want them to pay attention now and not wait until that's available. Let me go ahead and classify that as secret. We're going to take a look at the interaction between both the email and the attachments classifications to take a look at that and possibly take a look at, you know, sending to someone from the outside to see if they can receive this information. And from a classification policy perspective, we'll take a quick look at what we're trying to see here. So it's going through and we're seeing a couple warnings for the user to help them before it gets into the system. First one is, first of all, we're trying to send some classified information to someone on the outside. That's a faux pas. So let's go ahead and clean it up right away. We can get rid of some of the first limitations as far as, you know, sharing that information. But more importantly here, we're taking a look at the document. The attachment is actually a top secret attachment. So the email needs to be that before I can send it. The send is blocked. Let's correct the situation. So go ahead and bring it up to the top level, top secret classification and allow that to go through and have it sent to the team. So we're going to take a look at, you see an Anne's email off to the team. Steph and the external ones was removed. We got the visual marking for the people receiving this, and that's sent off. So I've shared it with the team from both the SharePoint perspective and also done it from an email perspective. And now we're going to take a look at the next few use cases on proper handling of this information. Now that's classified, let's take a look at how NextLabs will put the controls in place to control that. So I'm going to switch it back to Peter, and Peter is going to walk us through the next use cases.
In this next use case, we're going to use the sample C file that has been marked secret and is only releasable to U.S. citizens. However, for the demo, Anne is going to send this file to all the other users. We will then show how data-centric policies will restrict who gets the file. So to begin with, we're going to log in as Anne. And here we see Anne, and we see where, as part of Steph's demo, he sent this sample D document to the other users. And we go to the inbox, and we can see where Anne got some notifications that not everybody got that message. Now we're going to look at this message, the sample D message, more closely in the next demo. But for now, we're going to dive more deeply into the enforcement process by having Anne send another email to the users with the sample C file attached. Now we know that sample C is secret and releasable to the U.S. citizens only. So what we would expect is that Chris and Dan, as Canadians, will not receive the email. So we'll start, we'll generate the email. We're going to go to Bob, Chris, and Dan. And this is the U.S. only attachment. So we'll go out and we'll attach sample C. And when we hit send, the classification will come up and we'll select that it is a secret US only message. And it's sent. And so we quickly get the notification that Chris and Dan did not get this message because of the releasable to attachment. But if we go down to Bob's inbox, we see that Bob did get the message. And more importantly, we see that Chris and Dan are no longer on the to line. And so whatever follow-on communications related to this message, they're not going to be part of the conversation. And so next, we're going to go to use case 3.